Over tourism, sustainable tourism, part two, tourism impacts and challenges for sustainability. The last session, part one, we looked at over tourism and the impacts over tourism was having at tourism destinations. And we looked at several types of impact based on environmental impact, social cultural impact and economic impact. As a result of that, or as a consequence, over the last decade, two decades, we have been developing ideas towards more sustainable approaches to developing tourism based on the concepts of sustainable tourism, which is very much linked to the refocusing and adapting of existing forms of tourism, balancing really the approaches to tourism development for the long term and linking economic, social and environmental aspects towards sustainable principles and sustainable development, including all stakeholders, which may include Indigenous people, local communities, visitors, the tourism industry, and of course, government. So it's really a rebalancing act in this respect, and sustainable tourism is all about that. If we take the Maltese Islands as an example, obviously, Malta as a tourism destination portrays itself as a typical Mediterranean island. This is Marshall Slot on the south coast, typical Mediterranean fishing village, the azure waters of the Mediterranean, all part and parcel of promotion and developing the ideal image of the Maltese Islands. And of course, part of that is the natural heritage and the built heritage of the islands as well. So the ideal image is one of a typical Mediterranean destination. But the reality perhaps is something a little different. Malta has moved from approximately 1 million tourists 10 years ago to 2.5 million tourists in 2019, which is placing more pressure on the environment and on the infrastructure of the islands. And we see now images, this is advertised in the Malta Times fairly recently, of perhaps the future of the island if nothing is done about sustainable development across the islands. And of course, these are just other images of that same, really. And of course, any visitors to the islands today will see these sorts of images. Several construction sites across the islands, particularly along the coast, particularly at tourism destinations. This is Spinola Bay, Baluta Bay, which is one of the prime areas in St. Julian's Salima. And of course, cars go part hand in hand with that. There's over 450,000 cars on the island, which is again creating considerable pressures on the infrastructure, on roads, and causing a lot of pollution and noise and congestion. And together with those sorts of images, we see now speculation, out of scale developments linked again to coastlines, really, and perhaps the inappropriate scale of some of these developments that are being proposed. And of course, linked to that are all the other things that go with mass tourism in terms of nightlife and the scale of developments, bars, etc., on the coast, which is again causing considerable pressures not only to the environment but obviously to the local people who live in these particular places. And now we are getting adverse advertising on sites like TripAdvisor, social media, that are actually portraying some resorts in Malta, this is Aura and Bajiba, as particularly not particularly nice places to visit anymore, full of sunburnt people. It really is all concrete, no greenery whatsoever. So these are sort of images that really we don't really want to have for the islands. So have we gone too far? Do we really need to stop tourism? Or do we need to control it and put the brakes on tourism growth? There is a plan. The Malta Tourism Authority has published its plan, and that is moving much more towards developing more sustainable approaches to tourism linked to niche markets. And one of the more recent initiatives has been V18 Valletta European Capital Culture, which has spearheaded the growth of cultural tourism across the islands, but that was also linked to other aspects of niche tourism development based on food, based on culture, based on natural and built heritage, based on the natural environment. And of course, that is very much now a key focus of the Maltese government in portraying and developing and promoting the islands for the future. And part and parcel of that is a whole range of events linked to particular niches as well, to support those alternative initiatives. One of the interesting ones which has been developed over the last few years has been the blue growth strategy linked to the blue economy and developing Malta's traditional maritime industries linked to sailing and yachting. And we're seeing a whole host of initiatives now. One of them has been the Rolex Middle Sea Race, which is now an annual event across the islands. Some images there, the development of marinas, obviously trying to change the image from a mass tourism destination to a more focused, not so much elite, but better quality, higher quality experience for visitors. But of course, this comes with challenges. Trying to create a more sustainable approach to tourism in a place like Malta does come with challenges. One of the key ones is mass and growth. There is a real difficulty in trying to change direction to stop or put a brake on tourism, because the interests of the tourism industry is one of growth, and actually to try and steer that in an opposite direction has quite severe obstacles in its way. And of course, strategic coordination in that respect is very much part and parcel of that, and the more and the tourism industry in general is a very fragmented, very diverse group of stakeholders. And that is the third really key challenge, is fragmented stakeholders, that trying to get everybody to think strategically in the same direction is sometimes very, very difficult, because we have diverse interests across the whole of the tourism industry. And of course, sometimes stakeholders aren't always supportive of sustainable approaches. Again, coming back to this maths and growth and development is one of those key challenges. The advent of rigorous green agendas is something that is causing a lot more uncertainty. The Extinction Rebellion, carbon emissions, climate change are all part and parcel of that, and how that will change in the future. There's a lot of uncertainty about that, but certainly that is another area that actually creates some challenges for us. Technical expertise, the ability to actually enact sustainable principles and knowledge and professionalism associated with that is sometimes lacking, and certainly education is part and parcel of that, and the knowledge base to actually try and change is another challenge there. And lastly, in terms of sustainable tourism challenges, economics and cost. Sustainability will come at a cost. There is a price tag to this, and of course not everybody wants to pay those costs or share those costs, and it's about sharing, and sometimes that is a challenge as well. So these are the sort of typical challenges facing the move or direction towards sustainable tourism. And I finish with a Richard Sharpley quote, which was quoted in 2010, but still pertinent 10 years later. The extent to which sustainability objectives are achievable within the tourism context remains questionable. As with all industries and economic sectors, resource sustainability in tourism is dependent upon cooperation between all sectors. Sustainability in tourism will only be achieved when the industry as a whole accepts the need for such policies. And I think that really sums it up. We need collaboration, we need partnership, we need to work together across the whole sector, from visitors to local communities to the businesses and tourism operations. Unless we have collaboration and partnership, sustainability as an end goal will be very difficult to achieve in practice. Thank you.